And we stand here with a mandate from the Lord Jesus Christ.
Go forward
and to reach out to a great many of the United States of America, but from this place, portions of our world.
Just a tiny little beginning of what we see today. Over these 50 years, it's the faithfulness of God.
Tonight, live from Virginia Beach, Virginia, a celebration of the 50th anniversary of the Christian Broadcasting Network, featuring Pat and Gordon Robertson, evangelist Reinhard Bonnke, the music of Mercy Me, the Annie Moses Band, and the Virginia Symphony Orchestra and Community Choir.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to CBN's 50th broadcast anniversary. I'm Michael Little, our scheduled MC for the evening. Pat Williams is ill and unable to be with us. I'm standing in for him tonight. And tonight we stand amazed at what God has accomplished over the past five decades. And we dedicate this grand celebration to Him. To God, be the glory for the great things he has done. This evening, we'll take you on a journey that began just 12 miles from here, on the shores of Cape Henry, Virginia, on April 29, 1607. There, men of faith and vision claimed this land for God's glory. They were determined to spread his name across the new world they were exploring. And from these same shores, the Christian Broadcasting Network has taken the gospel to the far corners of the earth. And all because of one man, Pat Robertson, who heard and followed the call of God on his life. Before we begin our journey this evening, I want to thank all of you for coming to this glorious event outside here in Virginia Beach, Virginia. And I want to recognize some distinguished guests joining us tonight. From our CBN Board of Directors, we've got the guests Bill McConkie, David Pentecost, and Tom Salzgiver. Also with us this evening is the United States Congressman Scott Ridgel, a Regent University graduate. And from our on-air 700 Club family, we've got Terry Musin is here, Christy Watts, news anchor Lee Webb, and Scott Ross, and former 700 Club host Ben Kinchlow. And Lisa Ryan and John Gilman. They're all here tonight as we celebrate. Now, as we begin our celebration with a song of praise to the one we honor the most tonight, Jesus Christ. Tonight, please welcome the Virginia Symphony and Community Choir, along with the Annie Moses Band, performing All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name, under the direction of Mr. Wayne Walton. Thank you.
mandate from the Lord Jesus Christ to reach out to a waiting and hungry world. And on this piece of ground right here where you're standing, broadcasts will go forth, which will cover not only the United States of America, but will cover major portions of our world.
We're doing TV. Now I get to tell you that our first speaker for the evening is the mayor of the city of Virginia Beach. Are you ready? His name, William D. Sessoms, Jr. Would you make him welcome to our time together?
Mayor, thank you very much. Well, good evening. You know, the Holy Bible tells us that the spoken word of God is like a living, powerful sword in our mouths. To Dr. Robertson and the entire Robertson family, thanks for having the faith to spread the spoken word of God to men, women, and children all around the world. I'd like to read a proclamation. On January 11, 1960, Pat Robertson filed incorporation papers for the Christian Broadcasting Network. CBN first began broadcasting from a studio on Sparkly Street in Portsmouth, Virginia, on October 1, 1961, becoming the first Christian television station in the United States of America. Whereas during its humble beginnings, CBN's signal barely reached the city limits, yet 5 decades later, CBN is broadcasting across our nation and around the world, bringing hope and inspiration to countless individuals through its humanitarian ministry. And whereas today, CBN is a multifaceted nonprofit organization that provides programming by cable, broadcast, and satellite to approximately 200 countries with a 24-hour telephone prayer line. And whereas the 700 Club, a daily television program produced by CBN, has been on the air continuously since 1966, making it one of the longest-running programs in broadcast history. And whereas CBN's Golden Celebration features an extraordinary festival with an amazing assortment of activities for all ages. Whereas CBN is very important, an interesting part of Virginia Beach history, employs more than 1,000 people in Virginia Beach, and it is celebrating 50 years of broadcasting. Now, therefore, I, William D. Sessoms, Jr., Mayor of the City of Virginia Beach, do hereby proclaim October 1st, 2011, CBN 50 Years of Broadcasting Celebration Day. And I'd like to present this to Dr. Robertson. Thank you very much.
Our next speaker is the mayor of our sister city of Chesapeake. Please welcome Dr. Alan P. Krasnov. Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Michael Little. I want to express my gratitude to everyone for your presence here. Dr. Pat Robertson, a man who has dedicated his life to helping others. Dr. Robertson, a man whose single-minded determination turned airwaves focused on entertainment into opportunities for evangelism. This is not just good ground, this is great ground. We celebrate you and your leadership, and I continue to pray for protection around your blessings. Thank God for you, and now it is my privilege to read a proclamation. Know all citizens by these presents that, whereas 50 years ago, after moving to Virginia from New York with a wife, 3 children, and just $70, Pat Robertson bought and for the first time in history, put on the air a Christian television station. And whereas the grand vision of reaching the world with the message of Christ's love and power is what still drives today the truly global efforts of the Christian Broadcasting Network. And whereas with TV studios and offices in such faraway places as China, India, Russia, Nigeria, Peru, and Jerusalem, I am delighted as the mayor of the city of Chesapeake, Virginia, one of CBN's host cities, to congratulate CBN's founders, Pat and Dee Dee Robertson, and thank them for coming here to establish the compassionate ministry of CBN. Now, therefore, I, Alan P. Krasnoff, mayor of the city of Chesapeake, Virginia, do hereby proclaim October 2011 as Christian Broadcast Network 50th anniversary month. In the city of Chesapeake, and encourage all citizens to join me in commemorating this 50th year milestone by honoring this impactful ministry with your prayers of gratitude to God, both today and in the years to come. In witness whereof I have hereunto set my hand and caused the seal of the city of Chesapeake to be affixed here to the first day of October in the year of our Lord, 2011, signed by yours truly. God bless you all.
Thank you, Mayor Krasnoff. It's now my pleasure to introduce one who is no stranger to this campus. He's a very special graduate of Regent University. He served our country as a lieutenant colonel in the United States Army. He was elected to the Virginia House of Delegates and later became Attorney General of Virginia. Please welcome the 71st Governor of Virginia, Bob McDonald.
Thank you very much. Good evening. Thank you, President Michael Little, Dr. and Mrs. Robertson, Dr. Bonke, all of the Robertson children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. I think you fill up the first 10 rows. It's a treat to have all of you here for this incredible celebration of 50 years of the Christian Broadcasting Network. I was here for the 25th as a first-year law student, sitting right in those seats, never dreaming that I've added this opportunity to follow in the footsteps of Patrick Henry and Thomas Jefferson as governor of Virginia. God is good and fulfills dreams. I want to say that this is a special place and a special city, as the mayors have indicated. Michael Little told you the story 404 years ago when those brave 144 men and boys, after months at sea, landed at Cape Henry and planted a cross. Now, Pat, it took you another 354 years to plant that cross here at CBN, but though the vision tarried, it did come to pass. This is an amazing place. Pat was telling me that that first broadcast, and I hope I'm not stealing his thunder, 50 years ago, he was 3 hours late and the transmission only went a couple blocks. Today, Pat, you were right on time starting, and the transmissions now go to hundreds of millions of people across the world. Pat, you've come a long way. You've come a long way because now the good news that emanates here from the satellite signals and the towers here in Virginia Beach truly transmit the good news of Jesus Christ all over the world. It's an honor to have this Christian Broadcasting Network here in Virginia's largest city, the home now in Virginia of 8 million citizens. This is a special place because it's given birth to so many ministries since that day 50 years ago. By the way, I was thinking, and my wife, the First Lady of Virginia, is also here with me. We were discussing earlier tonight that there are so few celebrations like this where 50 years from the inception of an organization that the founder is still here, still in the job, still leading with the same vision that he gave birth to the organization some 50 years ago. I'm particularly impressed because I can't keep a job for more than 4 years. Pat, I'm really impressed. But giving birth to the great ministry some three decades ago of Operation Blessing, a ministry now that takes care of people with food and shelter and medicines and clothing all over the world. Just last year, 70 million pounds of food, nearly 815,000 people that were given medical care on, rendering support in after floods and hurricanes and natural disasters, showing the love of God to people in need, dishing out things that they need. Giving birth to Regent University, I had the pleasure of being in that first graduating class from the law school back in 1989. The school has come a tremendous way since that time. But it was here that I learned some of those critically important things about the ministry of Jesus. His words that he came not to serve, not to be served, but in fact to serve. And instructing his disciples that the greatest among them was the servant of all. Something all of us in public service try to listen and to emulate. I also learned that it is in the giving that you receive. What a concept for the world. How much greater would the world be if we all captured that message? Fortunately, America does that better than any nation on earth. We are the most generous people because of that Judeo-Christian tradition that was planted on these shores 4 centuries ago. So, Pat, I want to commend you and Dee Dee for your faithful vision. $70, an old car, and a vision. That's amazing. And look what God has done because of your faithfulness and those of hundreds of thousands of CBN partners that have joined with you, that have prayed, that have donated, that have done the work, that have volunteered, that have made the phone calls. It is truly an amazing vision that has unfolded. We're particularly excited because CBN now employs 1,500 people in Virginia, all over this region and our faculty around the world. $150 million impact on the economy of our state. We're particularly grateful for that tremendous economic impact on the region. So I want to say to you, Pat, for your tremendous work and what you have done to bring people together, and you're continuing to share the good news in such an amazing way around the globe. We wish you Godspeed, and I look forward to being back here for the 100th anniversary in 50 more years. God bless all of you.
It was 1961 indeed. At 3 o'clock in the afternoon and that year it was on a Sunday, Pat Robertson made his first ever appearance on television. And on that program, he was praying in front of a cross made out of cardboard. The TV picture was black and white. And that signal that went out was halting and shaky, and there was only one camera in that ramshackle studio. And the equipment broke down. The signal stopped twice that afternoon. But from that initial broadcast in Portsmouth, Virginia, the gospel has gone to the uttermost parts of the earth. Watch this.
CBN, the Christian Broadcasting Network.
It doesn't seem like that to me. We were right, in 61.
Yeah, you're right, Pat. We hate to be.
Hi, everybody. Welcome.
The Bible says that if you believe in Lord Jesus, that's right.
Look, it's like as far as we can see down there.
Hallelujah.
When you turn on the 700 Club, you're watching a program that has been on the air continuously since 1966. It's one of the longest-running daily programs in television history.
Probably seen more people come to the Lord through CBN than any other organization in the world. But it wasn't me, it was God.
It was an unbelievable leap of faith for a man who didn't own a TV set to jump into telecommunications.
I didn't have any money, but a lot of faith, I suppose. So I got an appointment with David Sarnoff, who was then chairman of the board of RCA, and told him that we needed some help and that we wanted to buy some equipment from him. Well, he looked at me and he said, "You don't sound like much of a buyer to me."
Undaunted by skepticism, Pat bought the equipment he needed from RCA to get the transmitter and camera working. 50 years ago, he switched on the transmitter, framed up the camera, and went on the air with his Bible in hand. The inaugural broadcast of the Christian Broadcasting Network made it to the end of the block, and from there, it never stopped. Over the decades, millions on every continent have responded to Christ as Pat speaks directly to viewers.
Lord Jesus, that's right, pray with me. Lord Jesus, you know what I've been through.
Today, CBN programming is seen in more than 100 nations around the world. Countries once completely closed to the gospel are now new frontiers. What began in Tidewater, Virginia, is spanning the globe. All the best human strategies in the world couldn't accomplish that feat.
CBN was the first ever to start a Christian television show in their own language. And that has profound implications for the culture. When you show people what Jesus is doing today for people that look like them, talk like them, it's not some far-off story that happened 2,000 years ago. But this is what he's doing today. This is how he's transforming lives today. This is how he's answering prayer today. Well, that just spreads like wildfire through a culture.
I wanted to be part of God's plan. And I think that his plan is for world evangelization and to bring millions to the kingdom, and he's let me be part of it.
In 1978, Pat was reading out of the scriptures in Isaiah.
Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter, when you see the naked, to clothe him?
With that biblical mandate, Pat started Operation Blessing. Early on, leaders like President Ronald Reagan took notice.
Operation Blessing. They've given nearly $2.5 million to more than 8,500 churches, and this money is then matched by the local churches. The result has been fantastic.
Now, Operation Blessing is one of the most trusted charities in the world. A fleet of trucks cross the nation providing hunger relief. Water wells are dug on every continent, and orphans are rescued. If a disaster strikes anywhere in the world, like Haiti's earthquake, the Indonesian tsunami, or Hurricane Katrina, Operation Blessing is there with emergency relief.
You know, it's funny. When you're walking with God, you don't have necessarily all these grandiose dreams about the future. What you have is, this is next step, next step, next step, next step, and you just follow where God is telling you, and you put your foot down, and the next foot, and the next, and suddenly, here it all is.
Regent University began with 77 graduate students in 1978. Today, over 5,000 scholars are training in the major disciplines.
Quality is everywhere. You step on campus, you see quality in the architecture, the way the campus is laid out, and it follows in the classroom, the way the instructors perceive their work. Students know it too. When students come to Regent, they know this is a place of quality, that we demand excellence.
The American Center for Law and Justice was established so that when the rights of religious people are violated, they have a strong advocate in the courts.
The American Center for Law and Justice is straightforward. We defend liberty and freedom. And when you defend liberty and freedom and take it as a mandate from God, it's something you do with excellence. And what we do is defend the rights of religious people to engage in free speech, to share their faith in the United States and around the world.
Dee Dee Robertson stands in amazement of it all.
I have seen more than I ever dreamed I would see. I have done more than I ever dreamed I would do. And it's just been a very exciting life. And working for the Lord is an exciting thing to do. following his leading and doing the things that he wants you to do?
The story of their meeting has been told before, but every time Dee Dee tells it, there is still a sparkle in her eye. They met at Yale. Pat was studying law and Dee Dee was getting her master's in nursing. Dee Dee says from the first moment she met Pat, there were sparks, real sparks, and a small fire.
Well, that's kind of an exciting tale. He came to an open house that the student nurses had, and I was trying to escape from someone else, and I said I had to work at the refreshment table, and I went down there, was nothing I could do, so I tried to look busy, and my hair caught on fire, and Pat jumped up and put it out with his bare hands. And somehow the fire that he put out in my hair moved to my heart, and it's never left. There were some very hard times, especially when we were first starting out, and I had three children. The oldest was 3 and a half, and it was just a lot of work, a lot of sacrifice.
I just thank them for the example that they set.
And that's, I think, what is unique about the two of them. They both were willing to submit themselves to God.
So they're a beautiful, beautiful couple together. God definitely knew when he put them together.
Their passionate love for Christ, faith in his goodness, and belief in his creative power are the hallmarks of the Robertson family and the heartbeat of CBN's first 50 years.
Never left my first love. That was it.
Now get to introduce was 17 months old when his parents arrived in our nearby city of Portsmouth, Virginia. And only 3 years old that day when CBN made its initial broadcast on October the 1st, 1961. Today, he serves as the chief executive officer of the Christian Broadcasting Network and as co-host of the 700 Club and the 700 Club Interactive. Please welcome Gordon Robertson.
I'll give you a little history lesson. Governor MacDonald alluded to it. Back in 1607, a group of English settlers came here. If you ever go to Jamestown and see those small three ships, if you can imagine a group of alpha males cramped up together on those three small ships for 3 months crossing the Atlantic Ocean, they had some trouble on board. They also had a chaplain, the Reverend Robert Hunt, and when they arrived off the shores of Virginia Beach at Cape Henry, he said, "You guys are not fit to land." And he ordered them to go through two days of fasting, prayer, and repentance to one another so that they could cleanse themselves before they landed in the New World. And then they had communion when he said, you're spiritually fit now. I think the role of military chaplains has changed. But they did that. And then they landed, and the first thing they did was they erected a cross, and if you go to Cape Henry, you can still see that cross, and they had a prayer meeting, and they dedicated this land to King Jesus. And then they prayed an unusual prayer, and they prayed that from these shores, the gospel would go around the world. Well, 40 years ago, my father was praying for what was then seemed like an impossible sum of money. He owed $250,000 on a new studio that had just been built in Portsmouth, Virginia for WYAH. And at the time, we thought that heaven had come down to earth and it was one of the best facilities we'd ever seen. But we owed money and the money didn't seem to be coming. And so he was in earnest prayer to God, I need $250,000. Well, like so many other times when we all pray to God, he's got something else on his mind.
And he told my father, I don't want you praying for $250,000. I want you praying for the world. And that started CBN on its vision to look to the world. And then we discovered this wonderful prayer from Reverend Robert Hunt that we were literally walking into prayers that were centuries old about how saints had come here to say, we want to see the gospel to the ends of the earth. And what you're about to see is how those prayers are becoming a reality around the world.
When the Christian Broadcasting Network took to the air in the fall of 1961, mass media outlets were limited to the big three: newspapers, radio, and media's newest outlet, television. Of the three, television's potential loomed large, but few imagined the scope this marvelous marriage of sound and image would reach one day. And just as CBN strives for innovation, integrity, and excellence in spreading the gospel around the world through television, today CBN continues that legacy by keeping pace with the constantly changing array of digital media platforms. In Indonesia, CBN's flagship website, jawaban.com, is currently the nation's number one Christian internet portal. It's linked to ministry programs such as Solusi and Obat Malam. The website joins text messaging and phone centers as interactive bridges for evangelism. In India, programs produced in regional languages draw growing audiences and change lives through dramatic encounters with Jesus Christ. Interactive discipleship is the goal of CBN's innovative web video portal, TipriTV.com. By offering content in four different languages, TipriTV.com connects South Asians living around the world. The 700 Club Asia is the longest-running Christian program continuously broadcast on Philippine National Television. Pioneering efforts in new media have resulted in over 1 million text messages yearly from viewers and partners. In Thailand, CBN is breaking down cultural barriers to evangelism through new media as well as ministry broadcasts, such as From Heart to Heart. CBN's Hong Kong-based OneMusicBox.com hosts the largest online collection of Chinese Christian music in the world. For Chinese viewers outside mainland China, CBN offers a customized YouTube outlet with on-demand access to the Chinese 700 Club produced in Hong Kong. CBN's first broadcast to Africa date back to the late 1970s. Today, ministry programs are seen in more than 32 nations throughout the African continent. CBN pioneered interactive ministry in the former Soviet Union by offering 24/7 toll-free telephone prayer centers to audiences as far away as Russian-speaking Israel. With over 90,000 cell church groups planted across the former Soviet Union, CBN is taking advantage of every open door for evangelism. From a regional center outside London, CBN coordinates customized international versions of the domestic 700 Club that are broadcast over a variety of satellite and terrestrial outlets. Meanwhile, an indigenous German team produces their own unique weekly edition of the 700 Club. CBN's broadcasts now saturate Central and South America with an audience-grabbing, Latin-flavored ministry across a wide range of broadcast platforms. CBNEspanol.tv offers daily internet broadcasts of the Spanish language Club 700 Hoy.
It's been almost 3 years since I accepted Christ. I want to thank Brother Pat Robertson. I may never meet him here, but one day I will see him in heaven. I am the product of men like him who aren't afraid to bring us the Word of God, even in prison. Thank you for all you do.
With over 90% of CBN's audience located outside the U.S., research estimates an international viewership at over 360 million annually. More than 555 million people have come to Christ as a result of watching international broadcasts produced by CBN. From a small TV station in the 60s to the digital media age, CBN remains at the forefront of using all means to fulfill God's ageless mandate to spread the gospel message to all the world.
Amen. We now have a tremendous broadcast platform. We have 15 production centers located around the world. We're producing programs in 39 different languages just this year, broadcasting in 138 different countries. And on this platform, we're going to release a new version of Superbook. Now, 30 years ago, CBN made the Bible the best-selling book in Japan through this cartoon series called Superbook. It was a huge success, with a weekly audience of nearly 4 million people. It was one of the highest-rated shows in Japan at the time. Since then, people in more than 100 countries have enjoyed Superbook, and it's been translated, again, into 39 languages, viewed by 500 million people. And now we're reimagining it for a whole new generation. Take a look.
In 1981, a cartoon series first aired in a small area of Japan. It soon became a worldwide phenomenon.
Here is a program that can reach not just the children of one country and one language, but can reach the children of the world.
Now comes CBN's all-new Superbook, reimagined for a new generation.
But I anticipate for the next decade at least, this will be CBN's number one project.
Produced by a team of artists, animators, and writers in touch with today's youth market.
Well, number one assignment for the team was to make each cartoon as biblically accurate as possible. And then number two is maintain excellence. Make it as competitive as possible to what kids are seeing in other cartoon series and even in animation movies.
Supported by CBN, whose global outreach delivers viewers from every corner of the world.
90% of what we do today is overseas. These same resources can be marshaled for a project like Superbook to get program airtime, to get distribution, and to get awareness driven that there's a great new program available that will be really good for children to watch.
The new Superbook is poised to reach more lives than ever before, presenting its truths in a way today's audiences demand and can enjoy.
Parents will be energized that they'll know this is wonderful entertainment for their children.
The first 26 episodes of Superbook will roll out with stories from Genesis to Revelation. But it won't stop there. Along with additional episodes, plans to expand Superbook's impact are already in the works. From comic books and mobile apps to online video games and community sites. The all-new Superbook.
What's it worth to change a generation?
Each one of the points of light on this map is a broadcast station that's currently carrying a television show produced by CBN. We want to use these same points of light to preach the gospel to a whole new generation through Superbook. Our goal is for 300 million children to watch this series over the next 5 years. And it's wonderful what God has done and is doing. And I like to tell everyone, yeah, while we're looking back over the last 50 years, get ready. The best is yet to come. Over 30 years ago, Billy Graham stood right here. He dedicated this building, and he predicted what was going to happen, what was getting ready to happen from the facilities that were being dedicated that day. Watch.
Jesus Christ said, "And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, then shall the end come." For the first time in the history of the church, it's now possible to preach the gospel to all the world.
Don't know how to introduce the next speaker. You get into the list of what he's accomplished and you kind of stagger just trying to read the list. He didn't just start CBN, he also started Operation Blessing in 1978. He started Regent University the same year. And then he seemed to get bored in the 80s and he ran for president. And he came back from that and said, we need a legal arm, we need American Center for Law and Justice, and then we need Christian Coalition to mobilize Christian voters, and we need to change the culture. And then he started World Reach, and let's reach the world, let's see 500 million people come to know Jesus Christ. And then in his spare time, he's hosted more than 15,000 television shows over the past 50 years. On weekends, he writes books, and he's written 19 books. I mean, you start getting through the list. I don't even know how many for-profit companies he started. He won't tell me. He won't tell Mom either. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand and welcome the chairman of the Christian Broadcasting Network, my father, Pat Robertson.
Hallelujah! Give the Lord praise. Thank you. What a glorious night. Thank you. Thank you. I tell you, you're involved in history. This is history. I was talking to my dear friend Bob McDonald, our governor, and his lovely wife Maureen. I said, you have no idea how fast 50 years goes by. And I tell the young people, and I've got so many grandchildren. I've got two great-grandchildren. My little great-grand, they don't know what they call me. They call me Big Daddy. I mean, you know, I can't be granddaddy with them. I've got to be Big Daddy. But anyhow, I tell them 50 years goes by so fast. It's just like that. It's all over. 50 years. It seems like a dream. Yet we started. God called me to come down here, as you've already heard. He said, you know, I want you to claim the airwaves and take them from the prince of the power of the air and give them to the prince of peace. Amen. I was supposed to start a Christian television station. And I came down here, and it's literally true. My dear mother, who was a praying lady, had sent me $100. She figured I was hurting around, and she was right. I'd spent 30 of it, and I had 70 bucks in my pocket. I had a wife, three children, an old DeSoto, a little 5x7 U-Haul trailer, a little bit of baby furniture, and some pots and pans, and that was it. And I came down here to buy a television station. And I didn't even own a television set. But God, over these years, has done wonderful things. And I started something called the Christian Broadcasting Network. And I remember years ago, there was a guy that wanted to send us a contribution. And he sent me $3. I've got $3 right here. Three little dollar bills, like that. And they were in an envelope, and so I took it. That was our first contribution. And so I took it, and I put it in a bureau drawer in the bedroom. And I opened it up a few days later to see if maybe they had multiplied each other. They were still there, the three of them. And so I decided that I needed to have some repository for our treasure, you know, as a good steward. So I went driving around the city of Portsmouth looking for the biggest, most prosperous looking bank. And I found a great big bank. It said Bank of Virginia. And that sounded, man, that sounded important. So I went in and I said, I want to open a new account. And the lady said, will it be a personal account or a corporate account? I said, well, it'll be a corporate account. She said, okay, what's that lady over there? I said, okay. So I sat in and I said, I want to open a corporate account. She said, what's the name of your corporation? I said, The Christian Broadcasting Network, Inc. She wrote that down. I said, where is it located? Well, we were trying to buy a place on Spratly Street. So I said, 1318 Spratly Street. She wrote that down, Portsmouth. And she said, what are the name of the officers and directors? So I gave her that, all that stuff. And then she said, you've got to have some checks. What kind of checks would you like? And I said, well, what's your choice? He said, well,
She had gold and she had green. I said, one was gold, one was for money, and I think I picked gold because it's better than the money. So we got gold checks and what was going to sit on them. And I figured, I'm home free. And then she looked knowingly at me and she said, in matters of this nature, it's important to make an initial deposit. And how much will yours be? I reached into my pocket and I said, $3. And then I reminded her that Jesus had multiplied the loaves of the fishes. And she allowed us as she remembered that. And so she wrote it down. I've got the deposit slip up in my office. It's true. The president of the bank brought me that little deposit slip, $3. That's how we started. And then she sold me a book of checks that cost $6. I was $3 in the hole starting out. But you know, the Bible says, despise not the day of small beginnings. And we started out, it was so small. I kept the books of this company when I was in the early days. Our first year, the total year of operation, our total budget was $8,000. Second year was $20,000. My dear granddaughter, where's the granddaughter? They asked me that question. Where is one of these granddaughters? There she is, granddaughter. Come on, stand up. You acknowledge. Yeah, come on. There she is. All right, she's a sweetheart. She's a graduate of Princeton. She lived in New York, you know, almost on Park Avenue. A few blocks away. Anyhow, it's called Greenwich Village. It's like Park Avenue. But she said, you know, how'd you all stay up there? How'd you stand it? I mean, it was so hard. Well, it wasn't. I mean, the Lord didn't give us any choice. You take what you have and you use it and you praise God for it. And you don't complain. I remember, you know, this philanthropist made a place for us to live. And it was in an awful neighborhood, dreadful house. It had one little closet and it didn't have any subflooring. So when it got cold, up underneath the boards would come this ice-cold air. The only room in the house that had any heat in it was the kitchen. It had linoleum on the floor, so we'd turn the oven on, and we could stay warm. Not a pleasant place. But I told my wife, I said, honey, whatever happens, I don't want to hear you ever, ever complain. Do not complain. If you complain, we'll never get out of here. So we praise the Lord, and after a while, good things happen. But, you know, you take what God has, and you praise him for it. Now, at the end of 50 years, I can look back, and I said, it's all God. I was looking around. You know, we got some pretty buildings around here, a nice building behind here. We've got university. We have 5,000, 6,000 students. We've got, you know, 14, 15,000 graduates, whatever it is. There's a lot of graduates. And we've even got a governor. And we have, in addition to the governor, we've got a Miss America. Then recently we had a Miss United States, whatever that is. No, was it Miss United States? Whatever, it was one of those misses. But anyhow, we've got Teachers of the Year. We've got, you know, had moot court champions, beat Yale out as moot court champions nationally. We had debating, negotiating champions, beat out Harvard. I mean, it's amazing what's happened. But it's all God. And he reminded me he had done it all. Everything that's good, he's done. And I've made a way for my life. That everything good, I give God the credit. Everything bad, I take the blame. You keep that in mind and you'll never fail. You know, there's a verse in the Bible that says they justified God being baptized with the baptism of John. I like to justify God. Something bad happens, it's my fault. I never blame God. Something good happens, he did it. This is all him. Praise God. 50 years we give him praise. It's his doing. It's his ministry. And I'll tell you right now, any of you that are young or whether you're old, God is absolutely faithful. You can trust him. He will never fail you. His word is always true, and I believe in God, and I'm thankful for him. So at 50 years, we're still praising God. He's done things beyond anything we dared to believe possible, and yet the best, as they tell me, is still to come. I'm moving along in years. When I was 80, I decided, just to show I was still alive, I bought a Corvette Grand Sport, 430 horsepower. It'll run about 200 miles an hour if the cops aren't around me. And I just wanted to show people I was still with it. So the next year, I got a big dressage horse. He's a huge thing. He's 17-3 hands. Great big horse. Wonderful horse. And it's kind of fun to... You want to be alive. So they tell me, you got to hang on a little bit longer. And I think, well, can I sort of step down? And they say, no, you got to keep on going. But thank the Lord, we've got these wonderful people. I've got the staff here is superb. Gordon is CEO. Michael Little, president. We've got Carlos Campo, president of Regent University. And I just sit over here and enjoy it. And tell them, well, I'm an old man, so I can, I've got all these privileges. You can bring me. I'll sit here and let you wait on me. That's a privilege of being a grandfather. And amen. God is good, isn't he? God is good. Praise the Lord. God is good. All the time. I have observed the working of God around the world. I've been privileged to speak to large groups overseas and see the work of the Lord. But there's one man, in my opinion, who has exceeded us all. And he's a man who was born in Germany. He started out in South Africa. He began very modestly in a little church. And before it was finished, he has preached to as many as 10 million or so people in one time over in Nigeria, enormous crowds. He had 1 million recorded decisions for Christ in one meeting in Nigeria. There's no such thing as a tent big enough to hold the crowds he preaches to. They don't exist. The fields are just jammed with people. And the miracles that take place are beyond anything I've ever known. And this is a man I love. I admire him. I congratulate him, and I want you to know it is our great privilege tonight to have with us a dear friend. I think he's living in Florida now. Why did you move from Germany to Florida? You know, come on, you should come to Virginia, Reinhardt. I mean, please. I mean, move to... Anyhow, he is the head of, what is it, Christ for All Nations, I believe he calls it. He's a man that has been used of God as in a most remarkable fashion. He's younger than I am. He tells me that he's going to keep on going. That I'm spotting him 10 years, but he's going to be just terrific. And when he gets a little older, think what he's going to do. So would you please welcome one of the great men of God in the world, Reinhard Bonnke.
Well, praise God. I'm deeply honored to be here today at this very, on this very festive occasion. I want to congratulate you, Pat, for the wonderful ministry that God has given you and how faithful you have been, how you have spread your wings across the whole world. I've seen them everywhere. And I've seen how God has blessed and honored CBN in all its different facets. 50 years is a long period. You know, let me put it this way. You know, in my own case, I think to measure my life, for instance, just by the years I've lived, what is a year? It's a time span. Our life actually goes from crusade to crusade, gospel crusade to gospel crusade. These are the time zones, if I may say so. And if I'm as old as the crusades we have had, I'm already as old as Methuselah. We've got that same vision in our hearts, put there by the same Holy Spirit. And that is to win the lost for Jesus Christ. Every time I take a microphone, I have a burning in my heart. I want hell empty and heaven full. This is what Jesus died for. That is the heart of the gospel. Jesus saves from sin and from Satan. And we need to preach the gospel from the word of God with all that is within us. I also want to thank you, Pat, for the help you have given us for our work in Africa. I will never forget. You have helped us so generously and so freely. And we have put it in right there where the rubber meets the road. We kept real books or records from the year 87 as to how many people received Jesus Christ as their personal Savior on our crusades. By filling out a decision card. And we have reached so far the number of 67 million people. 67 million. I thank God, 67 million less in hell. 67 million more in heaven. Hallelujah. There's joy in heaven over one sinner that repents. And when I hear your figures here, I feel so small. But I thank God that we can stand shoulder to shoulder in this great and mighty harvest of God. The Word of God, the Gospel of Jesus Christ. I just would like to share something from my heart, from the Word of God, for a few minutes here this evening, and I believe it will bless you as it also has blessed me. I make sure that every message I preach is based on the Word of God. It has to. You know, the Bible is not just a collection of Christian opinions. It is the eternal Word of God. There's power in the gospel of Jesus Christ. I believe that with all of my heart. I never forget when a 17-year-old young man came to me as I left a meeting, and he pointed to my Bible and he said to me, "Preacher, I don't like your book." I said, "No, why don't you like it?" He said, "This book is 2,000 years old and I'm just 17. I didn't tell him this book is much older than 2,000 years. "I'm just 17, he said. "I don't want to live by something so old," he said. "As a matter of fact, it is antique. I am modern. I want to live the modern way. I belong to the now generation." It was in the middle of the day. The sun was shining. I put my arm around his shoulder. I said, "Young man, have a look at the sun. The sun is much older than 2,000 years. Yet, I've never heard anybody say, 'I'm cold because the sun is old.'" "Yes, the sun is old, but very hot. And the Bible is old, but very powerful." We keep preaching this glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. I I've been looking at the imperatives of Jesus, the imperatives of God. We read, for instance, in John 4, verse 4, where it says, he, Jesus, must needs go through Samaria. Must. There was somehow a compulsion. There are many musts. Musts of God in the Word of God. For instance, Luke says, in Luke we read, Jesus says, I must be about my Father's business. Or, I must preach the kingdom of God. Twice he said, the Son of Man must suffer many things. This must. There was a must in the life and in the ministry of Jesus. Something very urgent. And then this must in the Gospels invariably mean an inner desire. Should I say a personal compunction? A must in the heart of Jesus. Well, Jesus said in John chapter 3, he said in verse 7, you must be born again. Knowing very well that we could not bring it about ourselves. And he hurried, just 7 verses later, he hurried to say that the Son of Man must be lifted up. And to say that in one sentence, I would say, put it like this. Our need became his need to fulfill our need. His must to us. He worked out and fulfilled it on our behalf. We can be born again by the Spirit and the Word. But we do not just read about the imperatives of Jesus. There's an imperative for us. And we find it, for instance, in Mark 13, verse 10. The gospel must first be published among all nations. Publishing doesn't just happen, it has to be done. Disciples and servants of Christ Jesus must be sent and they must go. It's our Galilean call and at the same time our Macedonian call. Go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. Go and preach. Go and preach. Now, we read in Mark 16, verse 20, and this is how the early Christians understood when they became filled with the Holy Spirit. It says, after all they had experienced in Jerusalem, it says, they went out preaching the gospel everywhere. And the Lord going with them, confirming his word through accompanying signs. This is very special. And I would like to put the emphasis here on this scripture. They went out, filled with the Holy Spirit, fulfilling their must as we fulfill our must through the various ministries, and of course, through all the churches. There's a German invention, not that I want here to advertise German inventions, but it's a new train. We call it in Germany Transrapid. It's a German high-speed monorail train using magnetic levitation. I noted down a couple of its features. That's important to me because I come to a very important point. It says the super speed maglev system has no wheels, no axles, no transmissions or pantographs. It doesn't roll, it hovers. Instead of wheels and rails, the Transrapid uses non-contact electromagnetic levitation, guidance, and propulsion systems. Wear-free electronics instead of mechanical components. Quite an animal, isn't it? But what I believe is this. When those disciples came from the upper room with that great commission in their hearts, endowed and endued with the power of the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit was something like that electromagnetic field around them. The wonderful thing about this train is that that electromagnetic field travels with the train. Where the train goes, there that power field is. And this is exactly what happened to the disciples then and what happens to us today. As we go in the name of Jesus, there is that, well, I won't call it field of radiation, or may I call it the field of radiation. But it's not contamination radiation. It's not radioactive. It's resurrection active. It's resurrection active. It works. I've seen it work in Africa in a mighty way. When I preached to 1.6 million people in one meeting, and the next day I had the count of the completed decision cards, and we counted 1,093,271 people who had given their hearts for Jesus in one service, I started to cry. I said, you know, in this one meeting, Jesus saved more people than in my 20 years previously put together. We serve a mighty God. Our God can shrink time. And I believe what we have heard today and seen today with CBN and the ministry of Pat Robertson is going to multiply. He will be looked upon as a forerunner of a new generation of men and women who have put their trust in Jesus and follow that field of resurrection power wherever they are. In Jesus' name. We are merging with the Holy Spirit. We are merging with the Holy Spirit. America shall be saved. I believe with all of my heart that today is the best day we've ever had to preach the gospel. And I will tell you why. Because my Bible says that this day is not the day of damnation. It's the day of salvation. And because it's the day of salvation, there will never, ever be a better day. May God help us to make use of this day of grace. Go out, the Holy Spirit going with us and seeing God in action in nation after nation and the whole wide world. I was in Switzerland. I spoke to a conference of pastors there a few years back. And I told them that in the first 10 years of this year, from 2000 to 2009, in our crusades in Africa, 55 million people received Jesus as their Savior. And that was not just by an estimation or show of hands, but completed decision cards. Some of the Swiss pastors, my friends, of course, came to me afterwards and they said, "Brother Bonnke, that is Africa. This is Switzerland." I knew exactly what they meant. But I said, "You are contradicting scripture." They said, "Which scripture?" I said, "John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world." You Swiss people have now got to tell me whether Switzerland is part of the world of John 3, verse 16. I said, if Jesus can save 55 million souls in 10 years in Africa, he can save Switzerland one Saturday afternoon. We serve a mighty God. We need to rise up with wings as eagles and not measure the height of every little fence we meet or every wall. If we rise up with wings as eagles, a flying eagle doesn't bother about fences, doesn't bother about walls or roofs or hills. He just flies in the name of Jesus. We claim our generation for him. Amen. This field of radiation, I believe tonight here, this is a field of resurrection, radiation for everyone. I was in Nigeria in the city of Onitsha. Normally I don't dedicate new church buildings. That somehow is not my job. But there was such a dear friend and he begged me to come and open his church, and because we are friends I said, "I'm coming." Sunday came, I saw that big building packed with 12,000 people. I cut the ribbon and I think I also had to cut the cake. And then I preached. And while I preached, there was a commotion. You know I'm a crusade evangelist. Commotions don't bother me. I just kept preaching. I didn't know what was happening there. But there was a Nigerian lady with a coffin of her husband who had died in a car accident. And she said, "I have seen a poster. Reinhard Bonnke is in town. He is an anointed man of God. If I could bring that coffin with my dead husband just somewhere close to where he is, I believe Hebrews 11 will be fulfilled. I will receive my dead husband back." Well, that man had a death certificate. Doctors had signed it. the mortician had embalmed him. He was 3 days in the mortuary. Now, what hope do you have for a corpse like that? But as they put him into the basement of the church, I believe that resurrection radiation started to work. I didn't even know there was a corpse in the cathedral. I had no knowledge of it. But suddenly, as I preached and as I prayed, he started to breathe. He came back to life. It's a fact. It's irrefutable, an irrefutable fact. It happened in front of 12,000 people. An irrefutable fact, if you believe it or not, it's a fact. To God be all the glory. There were two men there, and when they saw him, they started to massage him. Later on, when I met him, I said, "You died of an accident. Do you still have pain?" He says, "Yes, I have pain." I said, "From the accident?" He said, "No, from the terrible massage." I don't think the massage was necessary. I want everybody to feel there is the Holy Spirit is more than just a doctrine. Some people like their religion like ice cream, nice and cold. But the gospel is the power of God, and there appear to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. I've never yet seen a cold fire. If we have the fire of the Holy Spirit, it will burn inside of us. We must go. Jesus goes with us. The Holy Spirit goes with us. And we will fulfill the great commission in the mighty name of our Lord. Hallelujah. My wish for this ministry is to continue as you have done so far. And I believe there will be a glorious and a mighty multiplication. There will come in future new alliances, I believe. New openings. The gospel is the power of God. Resurrection active. I preached in Khartoum in Sudan. I had an invitation from a government minister. That's 10 years ago. I must please come for an Easter celebration. They had given the local Christians the right to invite a foreign speaker, and somehow they came to me. I said, "Well, sick Easter, I was not allowed to call our crusade a gospel crusade." They said, "Easter celebration." I said, "All right then, I always celebrate Easter 6 full days. So we had a gospel crusade, or rather Easter celebration, for 6 full days. They said, "Oh, here, only a handful of Christians are in Khartoum. They will come." I said, "It's okay, I'm coming." We airlifted our equipment to Sudan. And then, it started. The first meeting was very small, only 30,000. Now that's small for us, 30,000, I didn't mind. But then, listen to this, I've never seen so many mighty healings after a simple prayer for healing than there. The blind people were healed by the dozen in our meetings. The first meeting, 30,000, The next meeting, the next day, 50,000. Then 80,000. 150,000. The last day, the chief of national security came into the building just before I left. I entered the platform and he shouted, "Mr. Bonnke," he said, "there are 1 million people waiting for you." Well, they weren't 1 million, but I like good rumors. We know how to count big crowds. We counted 220,000. But that man, I've never seen such a crowd. And then I knew it. It's the gospel of signs and wonders that will prevail. And if God opens doors for us to preach in countries where the gospel is not known, I believe the gospel, in cooperation with the Holy Spirit, will prevail. Jesus is Lord. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Hallelujah. Glory to God in the highest. In closing, I would like to say that I pray that the blanket of sickness may leave. Blanket of compulsions may leave. And that resurrection field of power may settle here. In Jesus' name, that you take a gift home, namely a wonderful renewal for spirit, soul, and body. In Jesus' mighty name. Lord, I thank you for what you have done. Thank you for Pat and Didi. Thank you for their family. Thank you for CBN. Thank you for those who run with the baton. Thank you, Lord, that you will give increase, that you will give grace. And Lord, let everyone come to know right now that glorious resurrection, radiation of the risen one. You live forevermore. You have the keys of hell and Hades in your hand. You are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank God. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. I want us to pray together these next, how many years? I don't know. 10 years? 20 years? How many years?
Of what?
For the future, what do we got?
Oh. Well, let's try 100.
Well, I'd like Jesus to come back before them. I want us to be up. All of us, everybody join hands. I want to dedicate these next years in God's service. And I'll ask Reinhardt to pray. Whatever years before Jesus comes back, if it's 100, if it's 5, if it's 1, whatever it is.
Amen.
I'm with you, brother.
Lord, I want to thank you.
Thank you.
For this holy moment.
Yes, God.
I want to thank you for my dear brother Pat.
Thank you, Jesus.
Your faithful servant.
Thank you.
And Lord, I claim for him,
yes, God,
what I also claim for myself.
Yes, God.
That our leaf shall not wither.
Yes, yes.
As you have promised in Psalm 1.
Amen.
Lord, his leaf shall not wither. You will give it strength and color, and you will continue to let your anointing flow through his life. Lord, I thank you for another 10 glorious years. Amen. In your hand, under your hand, and in your power. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. God bless you. I love you. Thank you, Reinhard. Tremendous man of God. What a night. 50 years. All I can say is to God be the glory. Great things he's done. What an inspiration. The miracles that this brother has seen. But what is it? It's the power of God unto salvation. As Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation. His power is mighty. Well, you've been here, and this is historic. You remember back and think, I was there, and 50 years concluded, and a praise service was there. Well, I'm going to turn this back over to Michael Little, and I think we have some more music. We've got the Virginia Symphony here, and the choir with them. And for all of you, thank God for you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for our faithful partners. I love you. Praise God for you. Appreciate you. And 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 100 years? Are you kidding? All right, we'll see. All right, here you are.
I was here like you were some years ago. There were stern-faced guards in towers with machine guns willing to destroy. And now these people can come in freedom.
Your vision of what you're going to do in Eastern Europe is one of the most thrilling things that I've heard. And I would say to everybody, let's get behind Pat in Eastern Europe.
Unsolicited. God bless you, my dear friend.
The short story about vocalist Bart Miller. He was only 18 years old when his father died. After that, Bart began to wonder, what would it be like to be in heaven and be in the presence of God? So he began writing down the words, I can only imagine, whenever that he was thinking about his father. Then, alone on a bus in the middle of the night, he completed the lyrics to this amazing song. And tonight, as we look forward to the next 50 years, we can only imagine how many souls will be in heaven as a result of God's blessing on CBN's commitment to take the gospel to the whole world. Now, please welcome Mercy Me singing I Can Only Imagine.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine surrounded by your glory. What will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. When all I will do is forever, forever worship you. And I can only imagine.
We thank all of you for joining us tonight for the celebration of CBN's 50th anniversary. The Virginia Symphony and our community choir have one more song to perform. And after that, there will be a period of about 15 minutes, a medley of hymns accompanied by the amazing fireworks of Boom Boom Zambelli. And now, once again, here are the Virginia Symphony and Community Choir praising the one who made all of this possible with the majestic hymn, "You Are Worthy." Thank you.
Thank you. Bill Wayne, Walton, the Virginia
and conclude.